So, good evening. I'm very, really happy to be here with you. Well, the last 17 years of my life, I've been traveling. I've been traveling a lot throughout Europe and now here. It's now 6 years, more or less, 6, 7 years I'm traveling here in this country, both on West Coast and East Coast, not so much in the middle. So far, I was in Montana, but I'm still learning. You know, it sounds maybe like I've done a lot, you know, but 30 years is not much, you know. I mean, if you want to learn piano or to play violin, you know, 20 years you begin to play badly. So, 30 years to come to understand mind. Its mechanism, and moreover, its essence, the stuff mind is made of, it's not much. So one of my teacher, a venerable old Tibetan Lama, told me when we were just about to begin our first retreat in 1984, he said, always see yourself as a student. If you consider you're a master, you're stuck. There is no way on. You're just stuck there, you know? So often we, you know, divide the world in seekers and knowers, you know? So I think it's not correct. Everybody knows a lot, not the same things. And hopefully everybody is still looking for something. So there's a dynamic process. Otherwise, if you're sitting here on this chair and said, I know, obviously I don't know everything. So then I have to lie a lot. And I'm so busy lying that the little I know, I cannot talk about it. Because I have to defend my position of knower. I have to convince you that you are seekers and not knower. You don't know anything. And I know everything. You know, so this is very unhealthy situation. So I learn a lot by traveling. I learn a lot by meeting different people. I learn a lot by exchanging. I love interaction. So if you have during this time we spend together any question or anything that you don't understand, don't feel like you know it's a sacred moment, I shouldn't talk, you're free to raise your hand and say, please, could you explain that? I don't understand. You know, I'm in this Buddhist scene since 30 years or more, and we tend to cultivate a sort of, I call it tribal slang. You know, because we're used to the concept of Buddhism, we're used to the words, the terminology, and we forget sometimes that there are people who don't know these words and concepts, you know? What is obvious for me, let's say after 30 years, could be very new for you tonight. And so if you feel that you don't understand, or that what I say doesn't make sense, feel free to intervene and say, please, could you explain it? Or could you say it again? Okay, that's a deal. Good. So, the topic that we picked up tonight is a four-line teaching by one of the great forefather of our tradition, Kagyu, or oral transmission, whose name is still Gampopa. Gampopa means the one who comes from the Gampo Valley. So, he was named after his birthplace. And he was at the junction of two main streams of transmission in Buddhism and Tibet. One is the teaching that came to Tibet through the great Indian master Atisha, Dipankara Jnana, or the torch bearer, the one who enlightens the path. And his teaching well known now here in this part of the world are basically emphasizing the cultivation of loving kindness and wisdom. Generally speaking, we refer to them as mind training. The word in Tibetan is lo jong, which means mind, lo, jong, training, mind training. So this is a set of teachings based on the lectures or sutra given by the Buddha Shakyamuni in a perspective of great generosity. We may aspire to reach the state of Buddhahood, Buddha the enlightened state, for our own sake, to free ourselves from suffering and enjoy a state of liberation that would be permanent. But we may also aspire to reach such a state to gain the capacity to help everybody, to gain the capacity to help everybody, to gain the capacity to help everybody, and so on and so forth. So these are different motivations, we could say, aspirations. And so one is called the personal liberation path, and the other one is called the large vehicle. On the one, we're going to try to achieve a state of perfection or freedom, cessation from suffering, knowing that at this point we will not harm anybody anymore, and probably we have a capacity, of course, to help. But the emphasis is placed on personal liberation. It doesn't mean there is no compassion or gentleness. No, there is compassion, there is gentleness, there are all these qualities, but the emphasis is placed on personal liberation. The second cycle of teachings that the Buddha gave were sort of opening up this idea of personal liberation in sort of a larger perspective. Great, let's work on personal liberation. But why not considering that it could be some collateral benefits? You know, we talk a lot about collateral damages, but we should talk about collateral benefits. So if I progress along the path and I free myself from old habits, neurotic patterns, all the scars and wounds of my past that come and haunt me and sort of contrive my life, I'm more free. And this freedom is going to help other people. Because when you feel bad, everybody around you feel bad. You know, this sort of spreading of your grumpiness. But if you feel better, you're more open, you're more friendly, you're more generous, you're more patient, you have more respect for yourself, so you have more respect for others. It's everybody's benefit we're working on. So the Buddha emphasized that aspect, and in his teaching, when Atisha moved from India to Tibet, after being invited by then King of Tibet, he taught that. He said, it's possible to be in this life working with whatever we encounter, and out of the emotional waste, recycle the emotional waste into the compost of Bodhi tree.